story begins in a tiny little town in central Pennsylvania. You kind of go to the middle of nowhere and turn left. And it's farm country, mostly dairy cattle. There were 82 kids in my high school graduating class, and it was not because a lot of us failed. When we got our first Walmart in town, that was big news for us. And that was where I spent my childhood, except for 1 year. The 1 year that I was 14, we moved from the small town in Pennsylvania to an equally small town, this one different because it was in Massachusetts. And for my family, that move was mostly a disaster. The new situation didn't work out. Spent 14 months of high family drama dealing with moving there, moving back, buying a house, selling a house. You know, in retrospect, my parents really could have done without the whole process. But for me, the one cool thing that came out of this, the whole disaster process, was that I had a fantastic biology course that year. So it was my freshman year of high school. I had this really enthusiastic and inspiring teacher. She talked about intracellular proteins like they were rock stars. And she was a woman, which was not necessarily usual for a high school small town science teacher at that time. So that year, living in that environment, where I had that course I was totally psyched up about and that teacher who was really inspiring, and I was living, however briefly, near Boston, which is where the headquarters of all the big biotechnology firms were at the time, I came up with the plan. So the plan was going to be my course for the entire rest of my career. I was going to go to college, major in biology. I was going to go to graduate school, get a PhD, and then I was going to go work for one of these cool biotech firms where you can cure a disease and get rich doing it. So, looking back, I'd say I knew myself at that point well enough to know that I wanted to be involved in healthcare, and I wanted to use my personal skills and aptitudes to help people. I just also had the teenage thing going on where I was going to be rich and famous too. You probably know some people like that. So, for the next 14 years, I followed the plan. I did go to college and major in biology. I did go to graduate school and get the PhD. I met and married my husband while I was at it. So everything was perfect, except that it wasn't. Because the further along I got on the plan, the more time I spent in the research lab doing science, and the more I started to feel like I kind of wanted to be doing something else. And that was a really strange thing for me to be thinking at that point, because the plan had been to do research, and I was doing research, so what was the problem? I tried switching labs, I tried spending some more time paying attention to my feelings, and what I found was that no matter where I was working, my favorite parts of research were not designing the experiments and getting the results back, which is what scientists are supposed to be totally psyched up about. My favorite parts were teaching the younger students how to do their experiments and then presenting our results at conferences. So it crossed my mind, if what I like most is the teaching and the describing, you know, then maybe what I really want to be doing is teaching, not research. And that was a pretty complicated thing for me to be thinking right then. Because scientists get kind of an attitude about people who leave research. You know, to get from the point where you're a high schooler who loves science to the point where you're a junior investigator running your first research lab is about 15 years worth of work. And not everybody makes it the whole way. You know, the hours are long, the pay isn't great, and to get a good professor job in today's job market, your work can't be just good enough. It's got to be amazing. So there are a lot of people who leave science to do something that has a better work-life balance to it or that pays more. They kind of get looked at as sellouts. And there are a lot of people who leave because they just, you know, got tired of it, couldn't take it anymore, never got that great paper that got them a job, and they kind of get looked at as washouts. So here I was, 14 years in on the plan, looking at washing out research, and I was feeling really insecure about that. So I kind of tentatively mentioned the idea, you know, first to my husband and then to some of our friends and family. And they all gave me this totally deadpan, like, if you want to teach, then you should teach. Because to them, that was a no-brainer. But I really needed to hear that at that time in my life, because I had gotten to the point where I was dragging myself to work doing a job that wasn't really doing it for me anymore. And I kind of knew I needed to make a change, but to find the courage to actually do it took their support. You know, their support immunized me against my doubts. And so I did go ahead and make the big jump, and it's been fantastic. What I love about teaching, first, is the students. Millennials are awesome. Do not let anybody tell you otherwise. Second, is I'm still involved in all of my favorite parts of science. You know, the discoveries, the wonder, the germs. So, if you look under a microscope, your human cells are going to be big. So these three guys here with the green outsides and the blue nuclei are your human cells. They're a good size. Much smaller than them are bacteria And then if you wanted to see viruses, you would have to even zoom in again, because viruses are another order of magnitude or more smaller than bacteria. So what I want you to notice about these germs, first off, is they're small. They are everywhere. Germs are in us, they are on us, they're on every surface you touch, from cell phones to doorknobs. And they are devious little things. They can attach to our cells, they can live inside our bodies, they can strip our nutrients out of us. And of course, if too many of them grow too successfully inside of you, they can kill you. So, hand in hand with microbiology comes the science of immunology, which is learning how our bodies prevent that microbial overload from happening. Immunology has kind of two main branches to it. The first one is innate immunity, which is the defenses that your body runs 24/7 to protect you from germs of all kinds. And innate immunity includes some things you wouldn't necessarily think of if somebody says the phrase immune system, like, for example, your skin. Your clean, intact skin is a fantastic barrier against germs of every kind, which is why you put a sterile bandage on a cut when you get one, because broken skin is much more susceptible to infection. It's not until germs get past that outer layer of innate structural defenses that you start needing all those white blood cells that people usually think about. Those germ-killing white blood cells, here they're in orange, are mostly members of the other grouping, which is adaptive immunity. So unlike innate immunity, which runs 24/7 for your whole life, adaptive immunity is something your body learns to do by experience. Every time you get an infection, you raise a couple of families of white blood cells that learn to protect you specifically from that infection. They clear it out, and importantly, they remember it. So if later on, if the same germ tries to double back and infect you again, it'll be recognized much more quickly and eliminated much more quickly. So what does all of this have to do with you? For starters, based on my experience, what I would really like to tell you to do is do dream big. Make the big plan. Imagine yourself 10, 15, 20 years out, really happy, really fulfilled with where you are professionally. Then break it down. Break it into simple, achievable steps that you can write out on a list and that you can check off as you go along. Anybody can daydream about being anything. But when you break it down into a plan, you've made it into a long-term plan, not a daydream anymore. And a long-term plan is real. Having that checklist in front of you that you know you're going down and you can look at and hold is your innate immunity. It's the thick skin that you need to protect you when people doubt your dream. One of the simplest and most powerful things that you can do when you go to make up your checklist is to take meetings with a couple of people who've achieved something similar to what you want and ask them how they got where they are. Most adults are totally happy to take a meeting with a student and talk about their career path. Most of us are flattered to be asked. If you're not at the point yet where you feel like you're quite ready to talk to a person, check out the jobs and careers section of your local library or your school guidance office. Next, and importantly, I wish for you that you would remember what I almost forgot, that as you go along your plan, check in off the steps. You own the plan does not own you. By the time that you've checked off a few of those steps, you are going to know yourself and your field of endeavor better than you did when you first made up the list. So the final goal may drift a bit, and that's okay. The real final goal is for you to be happy and fulfilled, not for you to have job X. If X changes into Y, that's all right. Because as you went down your list, checking off each of those steps, each of those completed experiences was something that you accomplished, you own. It belongs to you and it's part of you. That's your adaptive immunity, the experience that'll protect you when the doubts are coming from inside of yourself. So please, take what I learned, plot your course, make your goal, live your dream.